The Pacific Northwest is host to three kinds of tectonic earthquakes: magnitude 9 Cascadia megathrust quakes, magnitude 6.5 to 7 deep earthquakes, and shallow crustal fault earthquakes with magnitudes up to 7.5. What causes them? We will show how subduction of the Juan de Fuca plate, basin and range extension, invasion of crustal blocks from California, and the resistance of the Canadian crustal buttress combine to produce these earthquakes. We begin by looking at Western North America's active plate boundaries. The San Andreas Fault is a strike-slip transform fault zone along which the Pacific Plate is sliding northwest at about 3.5 centimeters per year with respect to interior North America. The Pacific Plate drags on that plate margin, and segments of the boundary rupture sporadically, releasing moderate to large earthquakes. The most famous was the 1906 magnitude 7.8 San Francisco earthquake, a 480-kilometer-long rupture. North of the San Andreas Fault, the Juan de Fuca Plate dives beneath and pushes on the margin of the North American Plate. Rates of convergence range from 3 to 5 centimeters per year. On January 26, 1700, a magnitude 9 great earthquake ruptured the full 1,000-kilometer length of that plate boundary. Magnitude 8 to 9 great earthquakes rupture the subduction zone on average every 3 to 500 years. How do we know energy is building for a future great earthquake? The ongoing compression of the Cascadia continental margin is being measured by GPS. Data, represented by arrows, shows coastal stations moving northeast faster than inland stations. Looking at this in cross-section, we use a spring to represent the elastic nature of the overriding plate locked to the diving plate. Graphs above show the motions of three GPS stations as the continental margin is compressed and elastic energy builds. When friction between the plates is overcome, the leading edge of the North American plate lurches seaward, creating an earthquake and tsunami. Next, we look deeper at earthquakes within the subducting Juan de Fuca plate itself. The 1949 magnitude 6.8 Olympia earthquake caused 8 deaths. Fortunately, it occurred during school vacation, as 10 schools were severely damaged and subsequently closed. The hypocenter of the Olympia earthquake was 52 kilometers deep, at least 7 kilometers below the subduction zone plate boundary, and thus within the subducting Juan de Fuca plate. As the subducting plate bends beneath Puget Sound, the upper part stretches under tension and fractures in normal faults. In 1965, a magnitude 6.5 deep earthquake occurred 60 kilometers below Seattle, killing 7 people and causing $100 million in damage. The 2001 magnitude 6.8 Nisqually earthquake was identical to the Olympia earthquake and may have occurred on the same normal fault. Strong ground shaking in the Puget Sound Basin lasted over 30 seconds and caused 1 death, 400 injuries, and damaged 40 bridges and 300,000 buildings. Deep earthquakes occur every 20 to 30 years beneath the Puget Sound and can occur along the length of Cascadia, where the subducting plate bends to dive more steeply. Aside from the forces applied by the Pacific and Juan de Fuca plates along the boundaries, more is going on within the internally deforming North American plate. As the subduction zone is locked and elastic energy builds, we expect to see deformation of the continental margin, as shown by these yellow arrows. However, this deformation is reversible because the edge of the North American plate jumps back to the west during each great earthquake before it locks again and begins reloading. If the load and release great earthquake cycle was the only deformation, the observed GPS motions would be this simple pattern shown by the yellow arrows. However, the measured GPS motions are more complex, indicating that Cascadia deformation is a far more interesting story. Let's look at that. Basin and range extension stretches from Utah into southeastern Oregon. To the west, the Sierra Nevada block, dragged north-northwest by the Pacific Plate, is pushing on the Oregon Coast Range block that in turn pushes on the Washington Crustal block. The resisting Canadian Coast Mountains halt the motion. These forces rotate much of western Oregon and Washington slowly around a pivot point in northeast Oregon. Unwinding 16 million years lets us see the permanent deformation caused by this rotation. The resulting deformation has broken the crust by normal, strike slip, and thrust faults with motion histories that are the focus of ongoing research. An important example is the Seattle Fault Zone that extends across the heavily populated southern Puget Sound area. Trenching, shown in the photo, provides direct evidence of south-side-up thrust fault displacement from a major magnitude 7 or 7.5 earthquake on the Seattle Fault about 1,000 years ago. This animation depicts exaggerated thrust faulting along the Seattle Fault Zone. Modeling of ground motions that would result from a magnitude 7.2 earthquake are sobering. Areas within a few miles of the Seattle Fault, including much of Seattle, would experience 20 seconds of severe ground shaking, an amount shown in this full-scale shake table experiment. How does shaking from the shallow Seattle earthquake differ from a deep one like the 2001 Nisqually earthquake? Because the hypocenter at Nisqually was 52 kilometers deep, the seismic energy spread out beyond the Puget Sound rather than being concentrated near the epicenter as it would for a shallow earthquake. A magnitude 7 event has up to 20 seconds of severe ground shaking. A subduction zone megathrust earthquake, like Japan experienced in 2011, will have the broadest impact. A magnitude 9 earthquake releases the equivalent energy of 4 magnitude 7 earthquakes every second over a ruptural interval of 4 minutes. Projected ground shaking for that event will be severe at the coast, but still very strong in the urban corridor, where ground shaking can last for over 6 minutes with slow back and forth motions, particularly challenging for tall and long structures. The tsunami comes ashore 15 to 20 minutes after ground shaking stops. The Pacific Northwest is a region of high earthquake risk because of megathrust earthquakes on the plate boundary, deep earthquakes within the subducting plate, and shallow crustal earthquakes. By putting them all together, scientists are able to create an earthquake hazard map for the region. Amplified ground motions in the sediment-filled basins of the urban corridor are of concern for all earthquakes. Exterior walls of unreinforced masonry buildings, constructed before modern building codes, often crumble during earthquakes. Instinctually, people run out of buildings during ground shaking and are often killed or injured by falling debris. The life-saving response is to drop, cover, and hold until shaking stops. Earthquake and tsunami education, along with construction of earthquake-resilient buildings and infrastructure, are vitally important in this seismically active region.